Here we go. Let's open up a little. Runner vibes.
We have discussed the makeup of an artist several times across various mediums, but as of yet, we have not taken a step back from the altar and raised our eyes across the vast moonlit fields before us. Expanses of nothing and everything. As a product of our timeline, the need for conformity has, for decades, been gnawed to the fractured bone, spawning unique, albeit ambiguous, emotional works. Enter Juniper Actias, a terminally online self-titled femcel of respectable, albeit peculiar taste. Perhaps her most commendable trait is the seemingly unending drive for improvement and iteration. Every shadow, line, pigment, accessory, addition, and modification is conceived independent of outsider influence. By incorporating questionable and tasteful adaptations of arthropodal traits, a sense of antithetical humanity is left lurking in the cesspool beneath layers of chitin, fluff, and flesh. Degenerate behavior stood as a monolith for all to espy. Each individual wanderer had been drawn to the qualities soon discovered. Shared attachment for this introverted, questionably stable creature from the faux north had grown. Second piece, the establishment of personality, had been found and placed. The third and final object of importance, that being luck, came in the form of a video posted by one I'm Danny, a fellow man of degenerate taste. Concise infotainment, which, upon virality, propagated extensive growth in Juniper's viewership, effectively winning her the quote-unquote bug girl lottery. The final piece had been placed. The gates opened, and the horde adopted this newfound pillar of chitin and carnivorous cravings. Whether prepared or not, an insurmountable flood of attention and praise was soon to pull Juniper beneath the waves, casting her down the current and forking off into a new unknowable path. A varied artistic portfolio presents a plethora of pieces to examine. However, our focus is narrowed on a small work-in-progress project spanning, at present, 10 pages of gruesome and dreary material, following a young woman and her wig-splitting friend. With that in mind, let's begin. Apparently displeased with our idle observation, she casts her gaze with vacant insouciance. The bathroom, cold and silent, the faucet left untouched, as delicate moths flutter against the wall under pale lighting. She is rather unassuming at first glance, a wallflower in the alleys of another tale. Her existence and activity, as presented, is patient and mundane. There is no hint of urgency, simply time to think. Might we have interrupted a private cleansing of sorts? Perhaps herself too fearful to expose what may be interpreted as weakness. Might she find it difficult to find solace and resolution in the eyes of anyone outside of mere insects? Whatever her intention, her privacy is her own, and we have barged in unannounced. Potentially a memory or an event preceding her lavatory visit, we find the girl with an axe, toting about two severed heads bearing striking similarities to her own likeness. Wandering alone in what appears to be a warehouse, this rather tame show of violence acts as a primer for what is to come, a routine killing of oneself in the presence of nobody, Yet no matter the body count, more must fall. Another clone, copy, doppelganger, brought to their end. Curiously, in a public building with nary a soul to be seen, a far cry from the inherent privacy of an empty warehouse. She is seemingly alone in this world, with only herself to accompany her. But even the most mundane tasks allow for a malicious self to manifest and stalk her until the problem is quelled. The only true risk she's encountered is the omnipresence of her own being. The first page to include any sort of text, she is likely referring to the doppelgangers which pursue her. These ones appear almost ghostly, glowing, featureless, and pale white. As a base-level observation, might this symbolize the lingering ghost of her past? Maybe. What exactly that past entails, we can't be sure. But what we can surmise is that she is adamant on killing off any lingering part of herself. These ghostly forms could be memories that have been cut off and left for dead, only to reanimate and pursue a careless progenitor. Perhaps they are the intangible, unalterable rarities of the mind. Constants of misery. Piece 5 somewhat supports this idea by showcasing a touch of gallows humor in the presence of a malicious, though restrained, counterpart. Something many are familiar with. Make light of a hopeless situation as a means of coping. It can't possibly get worse if we laugh at our misfortune. A series of x-rays in a room of pitch. An exit sign glows at the supposed end of the lineup, but the girl with an axe is blocked by the presence of another ghostly doppelganger. Except this one is adorned with a halo. Crooked and blank in expression, it stalks its prey, who moves further up the internal line. Always a few steps ahead of this creature lurking inside, the self is incapable of turning back toward the exit, without crossing paths or deviating into unknowable, dangerous territory. A hopeless conflict in a land perilous, yet familiar. Body and mind shrouded in nothing, with innumerable avenues for a predator to approach. She may travel upstream, closer to the source of her ailment, all the while pinned by a creature she is all too accustomed to, much like this place itself. Battered, bloody, bruised, and beaten, the cat is not aggressive, rather protective of this cruel lifestyle which it had been subjected to. One like that of the girl with the axe, it is pained, afraid, and defensive, unable to truly escape what it has become accustomed to. When offered relief, freedom, it does not fight. It clings tightly to its savior, another wounded soul in a world hellbent on eviscerating individuality. These cats, which give chase, show analogous traits with the doppelgangers we have seen thus far. Halos, pale skin, muted, cheerful expressions. Much like the others, they do not feel sensation. Repeated assaults, regardless of losses, do not dissuade further attacks nor stifle mood. Dozens may fall, while an innumerable horde takes their place. Ultimately, the fate of the cat is left somewhat ambiguous, though we might assume that it has been saved. For the first time, the girl with an axe shows some sort of gleeful shift in the wake of her homicidal advance. If destruction of self can truly be considered homicide, that is. It is almost as though the lurking threat which catalyzed her grief is now cause for mania or some sort of joy. Posing before a missing dog poster from ages past, imitating the same animal with her hand, we are presented a row of considerably sharp teeth, eyes glittering in the sparse light, a ravenous grin, and a predatory undertone. A turning point? Or possibly a break in composure. Future entries may hold further answers. A literal bloodbath fixed for the doppelganger, who stalked the blackened halls of inner being, disemboweled, gingerly held by the likely assailant. Life, if indeed once living, has slipped. All which separates this one from the rest is the halo, fractured by suffering. In the arms of her own, she will fade away into memory. One such being of self, which can barely be distinguished as independent from the horde of ill-meaning manifestations, copycats, and/or charlatans. As for the girl, her expression has returned to that of indifference. Perhaps a touch of sorrow? Regret? Disheartened acceptance? This woman is ever difficult to read. Her story, for now at least, comes to a close. Juniper Actias is one such example of a prolific artist who has rightfully found their hive. Her monument is her own, one absent of snake oil and cut corners. A vision realized atop the mud, worth the respect and praise she has earned. Inevitably, the architect will fall. Such is the nature of existence. But their work, their construct, and their success will stand as both shining personal achievement and modern inspiration for budding artists. The charlatans, the uninspired copies, the doppelgangers, destined to be memorialized as a footnote, and nothing more. Thank you for your time and support, no matter how brief. Happy, immensely, belated anniversary. Life is a fickle thing, is it not? Have a pleasant day.